Guide to Digital Photography: How to Take Pictures Like a Pro. Introduction. I got my first camera when I was 10 years old. It was one of those slim little Kodak models that took 110 film and required a separate flash that clicked onto the top. Sometimes the flash wouldn't work and you'd waste a picture. Or when you finally got your pictures developed, you'd find a lot of them out of focus or completely not what you wanted. My grandson will be getting his first camera for Christmas this year. It's a digital camera in bright colors with a nice big preview screen where he can look at the pictures he's taken and delete them if he wants to. He's 3 years old. The business and pleasure of photography has come a long way since the first patent was issued for a camera in 1840. Over the years, we've seen cameras get smaller and smaller, move from separate flashes to built-in flashes, and finally to the absence of film with the digital camera. Photography is a pastime that is growing in popularity with the rise in digital cameras and the ease with which an everyday person can obtain a beautiful photograph. No longer is it necessary to haphazardly take pictures and hope you got the shots you really wanted. No longer will you have to make a special trip to get film processed. No longer will you have to wait 3 or 4 days just for your prints. Now, there are so many options, including simply printing out your pictures on your home printer. Touching up and manipulating pictures has also been made easier, no longer required to be performed by a photography expert. Software programs are now available that let the everyday camera owner play with their pictures and use them to make all sorts of creative projects. The advantages of digital photography are great. You have instant gratification with your pictures. You can immediately see the picture you've taken on the LCD screen and retake it if you're not happy. Since you're able to delete photos that you do not want, you have the freedom to shoot many photos of the same scene and just keep the one or two that turned out the best. Once you discover this, you have another great way to capture memories. You no longer have to shoot a whole roll of film just to get a few good pictures. With digital photography, you only print the best shots. You can use your home printer or get professionally done prints at sites like snapfish.com and others. You also have many, many options with digital images. Whether it's 4x6-inch prints to put in your photo album, homemade greeting cards printed on your inkjet printer, or sharing your photos online, digital photography opens up a whole new world of options for your memories. You'd think photography was made ultimately easy and a no-brainer with these digital miracles, and it really is easier than it ever has been. However, the truth is that there are still fine points, tips, and tricks to learn so you can be sure the pictures you're taking will be everything you want and more. Professional photographers know about this. It's time you should too. What better satisfaction than being able to take your own family photos and not have to worry about going to a studio to have them taken? We're not saying that photography studios aren't capable. Oh, to the contrary. There will be moments you'll want captured by the professional. But in general, digital photography has made those kinds of trips and events drastically reduced. We have done extensive research into the world of digital photography and photography in general so that we can bring you this amazing book. This author has already learned so much, and I'm just beginning to write this book. I'm surprised at how much I didn't know about taking pictures. We'll start by looking at what kind of digital camera you'll want that will meet your own needs, and go from there. Read on for Digital Photography Basics, Being Your Own Photographer. Finding the right camera. There are tons and tons of digital cameras available for sale these days. The differences can be quite confusing. Many people just look at price, but that may not be the best way to find the right camera for you. If you're just the casual picture taker, you won't need all the bells and whistles that come with a professional type camera. But you also want to make sure you're getting a product that will make your pictures look great at your inexperienced hands. Even if you are a photography enthusiast, you can benefit from this information too. There are things in this book that you may not have thought about before. Things like shutter speed, pixel size, memory storage, etc. All of these things can make a difference in the type of pictures that you take. So what should you consider when buying your first digital camera? Believe it or not, there are some very important things you should be thinking about. First is money. Determine how much money you want to spend on your new camera. Setting a price range will allow you to target models that are affordable for you and keep you away from buying something you really don't need anyway. What will you be photographing? Do you expect your pictures to be mostly of the family, or will it be of scenic views during your travels? You need to have a camera that best meets your needs. For example, if you're going to be shooting a lot of sports or action pictures, you'll probably want a camera that can shoot at high speeds. Will you be shooting a lot of close-ups or frequently taking photos from a distance? You'll need a camera with zoom capabilities, at least 3x zoom. Let's say you're at your son's high school graduation, and you're in the very last row bleachers because you were running late getting to the school. You can still get a great picture of Junior getting his diploma if you have zoom capabilities. I've owned a digital camera without zoom and will never again go that route, believe me. Do you know what you're doing when it comes to cameras and picture taking? If you're a beginner, you're going to be better off picking a camera that's easy to use. You'll probably also want most of your features automated, such as flash, exposure, etc. If you're more experienced, you'll most likely want a little more control over your photos. So by all means, go a different route. Figure out what your photo printing needs are. For casual use, a basic 2-megapixel model will be fine. If, however, you're planning on making prints larger than 4x6, you'll want a camera with more megapixels. We'll get into that in the next chapter. Digital cameras are great because you can store lots of images on your computer and share them through email, etc. But think about where you'll be storing your images. If you have a computer with not much memory and no CD burner, you should probably stay away from the high-end cameras. Your images will be too large to store and you'll have no way to save them. Be sure to select a model with a good LCD screen, even if you don't think you need one at all. At the store, examine the screen in the light and be sure you can see the images well. Almost every camera has an LCD screen, so you shouldn't pay more to get it. But it's a good idea to be sure it's large, easy to see, and shows good detail. One of the best parts of having an LCD screen is if someone says, "Oops, my eyes were closed," you can view the image and retake it if necessary. The LCD also gives you access to the camera's menu system, which will allow you to change the settings of the camera fairly easily. The LCD will allow you to view all the images on your memory card. You can flip through the stored shots and delete the ones you don't want to keep. The LCD will draw a lot of power from the battery, so there may be situations when you don't have access to your battery charger when the viewfinder is a better option. It's also better to use the LCD rather than the viewfinder when shooting close up due to the accuracy of the framing. Basically, what you see is what you'll get. Also, consider what type of battery your camera will use. It's best to get one that operates off standard AA or AAA batteries instead of proprietary ones, those made only by the manufacturer. And don't bother buying regular batteries for your digital camera, you'll go broke. Invest money instead into rechargeable batteries and a charger. In the long run, it's the very best route to go. The type of warranty offered can also be a hard decision. Most will come with a standard manufacturer's warranty. But you can often purchase an extended warranty as well for things like parts and labor. You'll also want to look into how to get your camera repaired if something goes wrong with it. Will you have to send it somewhere, or can it be done locally? If you're sending it away, will it be fixed by an authorized service center, and what is the turnaround time? You may find that being without your camera is more difficult than you think. Choose 2 or 3 of the above features and determine which of those is most important to you. When you do that, you can quickly narrow down your choices. If your budget only allows you to spend $250, but you want quality prints, look for the camera in your price range with the most megapixels. Speaking of megapixels, what exactly are we talking about? The importance of megapixels. One big part of the digital camera will be the number of megapixels it has and whether or not it will be enough for the type of photos you want to print. Basically, megapixels are a unit of measurement in an image. If you think of your picture as a series of dots, which it is, the more densely the dots are put together, the better your picture will look. The number of megapixels will determine the quality of your final photo. If you choose too few, your pictures won't be what you want them to be. If you choose too many, you're probably going to be spending more money than you need to. The higher the number of pixels, the better the resolution. The higher the resolution, the larger and higher quality prints you can make. Higher quality photos take up more space on your media card, but they will give you the best prints. For many people, this is the most difficult part of buying a digital camera. How much is enough, and how much is too much? Here are a few pointers to help you along the way. 2 megapixels or less. This is typically found on smaller, inexpensive cameras or cameras in combination with other devices, such as cell phones or PDAs. It will be hard to make a high-quality print of any size, but these are just fine for emailing photos or posting photos for a personal website. Cameras with this range are not recommended for family portraits or if you really need a nice-looking print. You can make some nice 4x6 prints and as large as 5x7 with good quality. Anything larger than that will appear blurry or distorted. Expect to pay $100 to $150 for the camera alone, more for a combo unit. 3 megapixels. This is actually a good compromise between picture quality and low price for most casual photographers. You can print lovely 4x6 images, decent 5x7s, and, depending on the camera, might even knock out a good 6x9 or 8x10. You'll pay around $150 to $250. 4 megapixels. You're getting nicer. These images make practically photo lab quality 4x6s and great 5x7s and 6x9s. You can print a nice 8x10 and even an 11x14. You'll typically pay about $250 to $350. 5 megapixels. This will produce beautiful 8x10s and even a nice 11x14. You may even be able to get even larger to a 16x20. With this camera, you're getting closer to professional photographer levels and the quality shows it. And you'll pay the price, around $350 to $450. 6 megapixels and up. Wonderful image quality, but high price tags. You can print large photos, even 11x14 or perhaps more, with satisfying results. There are some high megapixel cameras coming out with lower price tags than most, but they usually have very few features. Unless megapixels are the only thing you care about, it shouldn't be, don't get a camera that sounds outrageously inexpensive for its megapixel range. In this category, expect to pay $450 and up, up, up. Yes, I know it would be really cool to get that hot new 6-megapixel camera. If you have unlimited funds, that's great. If you're like the rest of us, working stiffs, you don't want to waste money on extras you don't need. And I can tell you right now, if you're just emailing pictures to your buddies, you don't need it. There are a couple of other things to keep in mind. People get nuts about megapixels, but more isn't always better. Higher megapixels mean larger image sizes, which in turn means more expensive memory cards and more space devoured on your computer's hard drive. So now that I've got you completely confused, let's make a few suggestions. Please keep in mind that these are just suggestions and not written in stone. You have to make your own decision. We're just trying to guide you a little bit. Suggested cameras. Choosing a digital camera can be confusing, to be sure. So we put together a few suggestions based upon your level of expertise. Beginners. Your photography style is simple and straightforward. You just want to take a picture and put it on your computer. You'll want a point-and-shoot type camera in the under $400 range. Find a camera with the following features. 3 to 5 megapixels. 3x optical zoom. Automatic exposure. Scene modes. Optional camera dock to transfer, save, and print photos at a touch of a button and also charges the camera batteries. This type of camera will be lightweight, compact, and easy to use. It is best used in bright light and may do poorly in low light, so keep that in mind. You may want to get a 128 megabyte memory card for extra picture storage along with a memory card reader. Rechargeable batteries are almost a must. A camera case is also another accessory that will make it more convenient for you to carry your camera wherever you go. Intermediate users. You are an intermediate user if you enjoy taking your pictures and then using photo editing software to tweak the images. You also know how to make fun crafts from your pictures as well as uploading them to the internet to share with others. Your camera is a compact style in the $400 to $700 range. It should have the following features. 5 to 7 megapixels, 4x optical zoom or higher, semi-automatic controls, scene modes, adjustable settings such as ISO, light sensitivity sensor, white balance, and exposure compensation. With its more advanced features, you'll have a camera that can do just about anything you want it to. In fact, it will have some of the performance aspects of digital SLR cameras, which are the ones the professionals use. For extra storage, look at a 256-megabyte memory card and a memory card reader. Of course, you'll need extra batteries along with a battery charger. A good quality photo printer is a must. You'll be much happier as well with a mid-size camera bag to hold not only your camera, but your extras as well. The professional. You are absolutely passionate about photography and everything that it encompasses. You always have your camera with you, and people are often asking you to take pictures of special events for them. You probably don't need our suggestions at this level, but we'll give it out anyways. A digital SLR camera is best for you. Because you are so into photography, you'll want a camera that can give you the results you imagine in your mind. A camera like this, however, doesn't come cheap. Be prepared to spend upwards of $800 to $1,000. Include the following as well. 6 megapixels and up. JPEG, TIFF, and RAW formatting. Zoom width and length to meet your shooting style. Semi-automatic and full manual control. A variety of metering and focus modes, including manual focus. Flash compensation. Save custom setting option. A hot shoe allowing for an external flash to be used. A DSLR is a high-quality camera with a high-quality lens and mechanics. There is little or no noise when shooting, and it can accept a variety of accessories and interchangeable lenses. It can, however, be quite bulky to carry. The professional user will also want several high-capacity, high-speed memory cards and a card reader. As usual, we suggest extra rechargeable batteries and a charger. An external flash is good to have in several situations. You may want to get some different lenses or converter lens kits. Filters make your pictures better, and a tripod is always nice to have around. A portable backup drive for your photos can save time and money when it comes to electronic equipment. Things can always happen with computers, but you certainly don't want those things to happen to your pictures. A large camera bag will make it nice to be able to carry around your supplies and tools. We've already touched on batteries for your digital camera. We think this issue warrants a section of its own. Power for your camera. One of the issues with digital cameras is the issue of power. Digital cameras require a lot of battery power, especially when using the LCD screen on the back of the camera. When you buy a digital camera, rechargeable batteries are a must. Some cameras come standard with rechargeable batteries, while others do not. Either way, you will want to make sure you have at least 2 sets of rechargeable batteries. There are several different rechargeable batteries on the market. NIMH, an abbreviation for nickel metal hydride, will perform the best, allowing you to recharge the batteries at any time while still holding their capacity. Lithium-ion batteries also hold their capacity fairly well. NICAD, an abbreviation for nickel-cadmium. Batteries are more temperamental, creating a memory effect if not charged properly. NICAD batteries will lose their capacity over time, so if given the choice, choose NIMH or lithium-ion batteries. If your camera came with a proprietary lithium-ion rechargeable battery, read and follow the manufacturer's instructions carefully. Order an extra battery and a 12-volt car charger if you can afford it, and skip the rest of this section. If it came with AA's or AA equivalents like CR-V3 lithium disposables, read on. AA batteries turn out to be a lot more complicated than anyone would have wished, but they're easily managed with a little knowledge and the proper tools. When in doubt, buy and carry additional spare battery sets. Along with ample memory, ample spares, and a smart fast charger with a 12-volt car adapter are the keys to carefree digital photography. If your camera takes AA's, don't even think of using alkaline batteries, even if you found alkalines in the camera box. That includes those pricey super-duper ultra-titanium jobs. Your best bet for battery power is going to be the nickel-metal hydride. In second place would be disposable lithium batteries. Lots of chain retailers carry disposable lithium AA's and nickel metal hydride AA's at reasonable prices nowadays. since nickel metal hydride batteries have no appreciable voltage depression or memory effect, feel free to charge them at your convenience. Be aware, however, that brand new nickel metal hydride AAs will need to complete 3 to 4 charge-discharge cycles to hit full stride. Only rarely will they need conditioning after that. Speaking of conditioning, never discharge a nickel metal hydride AA below 1 volt. Actually, your camera will probably die and stop drawing your AAs down long before that happens. But in the event you want to recharge before the batteries are fully spent, you should wait until you reach that 1 volt minimum. If your camera came with disposable lithium CR-V3 batteries, and your nickel metal hydride AAs aren't ready for prime time, resist the urge to shoot up the CR-V3s as they make ideal emergency and cold weather backups for your camera bag. Okay, so now you know what kind of camera you want. How do you go about getting the best deal you can? Let's go shopping. Making the deal. Because you're going to be investing some money into your new camera, you will, of course, want to get the best deal you can. That means the type of camera you need and or want for the least amount of money possible. How do you find that? You may be best off looking for expert help when purchasing a digital camera, particularly if you're a first-time buyer. You may want to buy from a local camera shop. You can't beat the personalized service and help from someone who knows cameras like the back of his or her own hand. Digital cameras may cost a bit more at a local camera shop, but it is often worth it for the service you get in return. A merchant may even lower the price if you ask. There's no waiting for your purchase to arrive as you would have to if you bought off the internet. You pay your money and get your camera right away. Buying online can be a risky venture, especially when it comes to the credibility of the person you're buying from. With a local shop, it's easier to check the reputation of the merchant along with the reliability of his or her service. You can hold the camera in your hand before you buy it and ask questions on the spot from the personnel there at the shop. They are even often willing to continue answering your questions after you buy from them. In addition, many local camera shops handle warranty and repair work, so you have some place you can turn to if something goes wrong with the camera. You will probably have better luck returning the camera or exchanging it for another one if the one you pick doesn't work out. Some online companies charge a restocking fee for returns. Local shops will most likely not do this. There are some disadvantages to buying locally, however. The price for a camera and accessories can be higher than online store or mega mart type places, and there may not be much variety to what is available right there in the shop. Brands and camera selection may be limited. It takes more time and effort to comparison shop as opposed to finding the camera online. Finally, you have to pay local sales tax. Of course, we do live in the electronic age where everything and anything is available to almost anyone anywhere via the internet. Comparison shopping is only a mouse click away, which makes it possible for consumers to get a great deal on everything from designer clothing to automobiles. If you turn to the internet to buy your digital camera, you will get a lower price, there's no doubt about that. But before you plunk down your hard-earned cash, be sure to do your homework about the merchant's reputation and reliability and weigh the good with the bad. Advantages. You can make purchases 24 hours a day, great for those with busy schedules. Significantly lower prices exist on the internet. You have the ability to compare cameras by category, price, resolution, features, etc. They provide direct delivery to an address of your choice. There is sometimes no sales tax for online purchases. Some online merchants don't charge for delivery. You can find a wide selection of cameras and accessories. Toll-free numbers for ordering and other inquiries are usually provided. Disadvantages. You won't be able to hold the camera prior to purchase to see if it's what you want. You must wait for delivery of an item. The camera may be gray market. See more on this in the next section. The product may not be in stock, requiring back ordering. There may be some high shipping and insurance charges. The company's customer service may be poor. If you want to return the camera, this can be a hassle. It can be difficult to verify the reliability of a merchant. There's a greater risk of being cheated if you're not dealing with a well-established merchant. It's up to you how you decide to buy your camera, of course. Just be safe when doing so. You don't want to make a huge investment in a digital camera only to be taken for a ride in the long run. There are gray market cameras out there that you need to be aware of. What is a gray market camera? The gray market. Almost all of the amazing deals found on the internet are gray market products. These are products that are made by a popular, reputable manufacturer and intended for and shipped to a foreign market. They are purchased by a dealer that accepts gray market products and then resold in the U.S., usually at a discount. While it may seem like a bargain to buy the same name brand at a lower cost, the risks and headaches that come with it usually far outweigh the few dollars saved, and you could end up with a camera you can't even use. If the price of the digital camera you're about to buy sounds too good to be true, it probably is. Before buying, find out if it is a gray market model, and if so, be cautious. You need to get complete information about the warranty, included accessories, and if they are valid or usable in your country before you buy. Aside from manuals and menus that may not be in a language you even recognize, and cords that won't plug into American systems without some adapter, these purchases maintain one overriding risk. They do not come with a U.S. warranty from the manufacturer. This means that if something, anything, goes wrong with that camera, you may be completely out of luck. In fact, some manufacturers will not service gray market cameras in the U.S. at all, even if you're willing to pay for it yourself. So if you want to get that camera fixed, it may require shipping to a foreign country and hoping for the best. However, not all gray market digital cameras are disapproved by the manufacturer or ineligible for repair. The camera may simply be direct imported with a valid warranty that is backed by the merchant instead of the manufacturer. Get it in writing, though, to be sure you'll have some type of warranty. If you're the kind of person who doesn't worry about a warranty, then a gray market camera is for you. You'll save a lot of money, but be aware that the camera probably won't work as well as its name brand counterpart, and if it breaks, you're usually out of luck. How can you spot a gray market camera? The product doesn't come with a manufacturer's U.S. warranty. In fact, this is the first tip-off that a camera is a knockoff. If there is a warranty, make sure it states both manufacturers and U.S. If it doesn't, it's gray market. If the site is not an authorized dealer for that brand, you don't know what you are getting. Authorized dealers usually stay away from gray market products, as this tends to hurt the manufacturer, jeopardize the camera retailer's dealership, and most importantly, hurts the consumer. Read the fine print carefully. Many websites will attempt to cover themselves by burying details about the nature of their products in the fine print descriptions. Any site that mentions may be missing original packaging, cables, manuals, etc. should be avoided unless you want to risk buying an incomplete camera. Not many people know about gray market products. If you come across a deal that seems too good to be true, pick up the phone and call the retailer and ask if their product is gray market. Most will be upfront with you about it if they're asked, and it's better to be safe than sorry. Now that we've covered the camera, you also need to think about a printer so you can make hard copies of your photos. The right printer. Again, getting the right printer all depends on how you want to use it. If you're printing for your personal pleasure, there's no need to spend tons of money on a super high-end piece of equipment. If you're going to do semi-pro or pro pictures, you will want to buy a printer that will produce high-quality pictures. The good news is that technology has come a very long way, and there are many good-quality printers available that won't break the bank. You want to have an inkjet printer, and they can often be found for as little as $40 if you look around really hard. Another good choice is a laser printer. Most of these printers offer good quality output for printing standard size photos, but pay attention to the detail because not all inkjet printers provide good quality output for larger photos. Although most inkjet printers produce a similar quality, the majority providing the maximum DPI, dots per inch, of 1200 by 4800. Spending more on an inkjet printer will most likely provide you with more features or faster printing speed. Keep in mind that many photo printers use color ink cartridges to produce black and white or grayscale images, which can lead to photos printed with a colored tint, So try to stick to inkjet printers that use black or gray inks if you want to print many black and white photographs. What separates professional photo printers from consumer models is that the professional variety can produce quality images at much larger sizes. Depending on your needs, printers accepting paper sizes from 24 inches all the way up to 60 inches wide are available. But because they are targeted towards professionals, many convenient features such as printing from your digital camera will not be available on professional printers. If you want to create large quality prints of your photos, maybe even posters, then a professional photo printer may be the choice for you, if you can afford it. Professional printers can range in price from around $500 to anywhere in the thousands. Most people will use their printers for more than just printing out their photos. Keep in mind, though, that your chances of getting professional quality pictures from printers like these aren't usually very good. They're fine for personal use, however. These days, there are some printers that are used only for photo printing. They have a docking station where you can attach your camera and download photos directly to the printer without even needing a computer. These printers are often much more compact and offer faster printing speeds. Print size is often limited to 4x6 inches, but the quality remains high, and larger models do exist if you're prepared to pay a higher price. Although the DPI, dots per inch, tends to be low on these types of printers, the output quality is high due to the use of thermal dye technology that utilizes primary printing colors in several hundreds of shades, meaning no need for dithering like inkjet printers do. Another great thing about these printers is that their reduced size makes them very portable. Some can even be battery-powered. When you're printing photos using your inkjet or laser printer, you'll want to make sure that the resolution is set to high, so that the DPI is high as well. That way, you'll have a better quality photo. Remember, however, that setting the printer this way will use a lot of ink. In fact, one of the factors that people often overlook when choosing a printer is the type of paper and ink they will be using to print their photos and how the price of these supplies adds up in the long term. It's not just the price to take into consideration either. Choosing the right paper and ink cartridges will also make sure that the photos you print are of the best possible quality. While ink cartridges made by a company other than the printer manufacturer may cost less, they will more than likely produce lower quality prints and can also cause photos to fade faster. Most printer manufacturers also create paper for their specific printers, and although it may not seem as important as ink, testing a sample of paper that isn't made by the printer manufacturer is advisable before making a large purchase. If you want your digital photos to last more than just a few years without showing signs of age, you should consider purchasing more expensive acid-free paper for your prints. In the inkjet world, this long-lasting paper is called archival paper. Depending on the manufacturer, paper quality, and storage conditions, prints done on high-quality paper may last 50 to 100 years or more, which is something you cannot expect with standard paper. Selecting the right printer can make all the difference when it comes to your pictures. There are also many places that will do the printing for you, all online. All you need to do is send them your images, and they will print them and send them to you in the mail. This is a very useful service when you want good quality prints, but don't want to waste your ink getting them. They are reasonably priced, too. Some of the major discount stores offer this service, but there are other online services as well. Here are a few helpful addresses. www.walmart.com for Walmart. www.target.com for Target. www.kmart.com for Kmart. www.cvs.com for CVS Pharmacy. www.walgreens.com for Walgreens Drug Store. www.snapfish.com and www.shutterfly.com. There are hundreds more, but this will get you started if this is the route you want to go. So, you've got the camera and you've got the printer. Now it's time to start thinking about how to take great pictures. There are a few things to consider first. Getting started as a digital photographer. Digital and film photography are far more alike than they are different. But digital image recording opens up many new, valuable, and perhaps unanticipated opportunities. For starters, assume that everything you already know about getting good pictures still applies. You won't find it in the box, but every digital camera comes with a license to experiment, test, tweak, and screw up to your heart's content. With the cost of another shot at nothing, why hold back? The pros typically take dozens of shots to land a few keepers. Now you can do the same, and there's no better or faster way to learn. Instant feedback is one of digital photography's most powerful advantages. Sit down with your camera's manual as soon as you can. Some cameras come with a basic printed manual to get started and a complete manual that will come on CD. You should read both. Digital cameras are sophisticated devices with capabilities you might not anticipate from your film experience. You might be able to fake some of the features some of the time, but you won't be able to take full advantage of your investment without a read through the full version of the manual. You won't regret it. Think outside the box. Digital cameras have more uses than you might have imagined. You don't have to memorize everything about your camera right away, but using it should become second nature if you want to be good at it. So practice every chance you get. Take pictures of your feet. Hold the camera a few feet away from your face and take an interesting self-portrait. The more you practice, the better you'll get. You may never get to some of your new camera's settings, but a few critical settings demand immediate attention, and they won't necessarily be familiar from your film experience. If you haven't yet thought through the many trade-offs surrounding resolution, the number of pixels recorded, and JPEG compression level, often referred to as quality, play it safe. Set your camera for the highest available resolution and the highest JPEG compression setting for now, and work out the details later. When in doubt, don't hesitate to take advantage of auto exposure and autofocus. Avoid auto ISO for anything other than low-light action shots. Try the lowest ISO setting your camera offers before venturing higher. Higher ISO settings bring more image noise. Many digital cameras behave like color slide film. The best images are often slightly underexposed, particularly when bright scene elements are involved. Use exposure compensation to feel out your own camera's exposure sweet spots, but count on some variation with photographic conditions. When in doubt, bracket your exposures. Sooner or later, you'll have to deal with other purely digital recording mode issues like white balance and in-camera sharpening. But it's usually safe to accept camera defaults on those fronts for starters. If you use your camera's macro focus setting for a close-up, be sure to turn it off right away. Many a non-close-up's been fatally blurred by a camera carelessly left in macro mode. If your shots come out badly exposed, even in auto mode, make sure that your exposure compensation hasn't been left at an untoward setting. One of the most difficult parts of digital photography that new users have trouble getting used to is the inevitable time delay that occurs between pushing the button on the camera and capturing the picture. Digital cameras have more to do in preparing to take a photo than do film cameras. Like film cameras, they have to focus the lens. However, they also have to take a pre-exposure to get proper color balance. The good news is that they are able to achieve better exposed, better color balanced, and in many cases, better focused images than film cameras. The bad news is that this action takes a fraction of a second and could cause you to miss a great picture. What can you do about it? There are a couple of approaches that are very effective. The simplest is to just push the shutter button down halfway as you're waiting for the action to develop. Keep it there until you're ready for the photo, and then press the rest of the way. Pressing halfway signals the camera to immediately choose focus, color balance, and exposure. The subsequent delay when you take your shot is now quite small, comparable to film cameras. When I'm shooting basketball games, I keep the shutter button half depressed, and I get great action shots. A second approach is to switch to manual exposure and focus. If lighting is stable, as it is indoors, this works rather well. Most digital cameras have tremendous depth of field, so focus is not critical. Set your focus for a typical distance, and you will probably be happy with the results. If this is an indoor sporting event, you'll want the shutter speed as high as possible, so choose maximum aperture and adjust shutter speed for proper exposure. Now, let's look at the rules of composition, and we're not talking about essays for school. We mean composing a great picture. Composition. Let's start this section by telling you that many people don't advocate using the LCD screen to set up and take your pictures. We find it's easier to do it this way, but it's all up to you. The art of composition, or putting the picture together in the viewfinder, can make the difference between a good picture and a bad one. It is a visual process of organizing the elements and individual details of a scene into a balanced and pleasing arrangement. Because what one person finds pleasing, someone else will not, composition is largely a matter of personal taste. There is no right or wrong composition in photography. A composition that conveys a photographer's intended meaning is an effective one. A composition that doesn't, or that confuses the viewer, is not. There are certain rules of composition that most photographers agree will make the best pictures. However, the word rules is used loosely here, as they are intended to simply be guidelines to take great pictures. They're based on recreating similarities in the makeup of many different images that many people have found to be aesthetically pleasing. A rule of composition or a design concept should not be taken as a hard and fast rule that must be observed. In fact, some renowned photographs violate all the rules of composition and are still excellent pictures. This doesn't mean that the rules are without value. They are tremendously valuable. They're time-proven and provide great guidelines for photographers at any level. These rules are great guidelines to start out with, but if you feel you want to break one of these rules, by all means, go right ahead. Photography isn't about perfection. It's about capturing images that will be pleasing to you and those you want to share the pictures with. Here are some of those rules. Number 1. Choose a primary point of interest before taking the picture. Determine which area is of the most importance to you and compose the picture around that area. Number 2. Be sure that only the images you want the viewer to see appear in the picture. If there are numerous objects cluttering up the background, your message will be lost. If you can't find an angle or framing to isolate your subject, consider using depth of field control on your camera, if it has one, to keep the background out of focus. Number 3. Give your picture contrast. A light subject will have more impact if placed against a dark background and vice versa. Contrasting colors may be used for emphasis, but can become distracting if not considered carefully. Number 4. Consider the balance of what you're shooting. Generally, asymmetric or informal balance is considered more pleasing in a photograph than symmetric, formal balance. In other words, placing the main subject off-center and balancing the weight with other objects, smaller or lower impact, will be more effective than placing the subject in the center. Number 5. Frame your picture. A frame in a photograph is something in the foreground that leads you into the picture or gives you a sense of where the viewer is. For example, a branch and some leaves framing a shot of rolling hills and a valley, or the edge of an imposing rock face leading into a shot of a canyon. Framing can usually improve a picture. The frame doesn't need to be sharply focused. In fact, if it's too sharply detailed, it could be a distraction. Number 6. Be sure the viewpoint is pleasing. You can often change a picture dramatically by moving the camera up or down or stepping to one side. One of the best ways to come up with a prize-winning photograph is to find an unusual point of view. Number 7. When the subject is capable of movement, such as an animal or person, it is best to leave space in front of the subject so it appears to be moving into rather than out of the photograph. Number 8. Linear elements such as roads, waterways, and fences placed diagonally are generally perceived as more dynamic than horizontals. Number 9. Use the rule of thirds. This is a principle taught in graphic design and photography and is based on the theory that the eye goes naturally to a point about two-thirds up the page. Also, by visually dividing the image into thirds, either vertically or horizontally, you achieve the informal or asymmetric balance mentioned above. Although there are many ways a photograph can be composed effectively by basing it on the use of thirds, the most common example is the placement of a horizon line in landscape photography. If the area of interest is land or water, the horizon line will usually be two-thirds up from the bottom. On the other hand, if the sky is the area of emphasis, the horizon line may be one-third up from the bottom, leaving the sky to occupy the top two-thirds. There's much more to consider, however. Take lighting, for example. finding the right light. Light, the primary source of energy for the universe, is the central image of many religions and the photographer's chief resource. The word photography derives from the Greek and means, literally, light writing. From the relentless power of full sun over water to the beam from a single candle, it is light photographers play with, light in its many moods and manifestations that we capture on film. Digital cameras use a light-sensitive chip rather than film to capture an image. The camera is designed to let light through a hole, or aperture, onto the chip for a limited amount of time, exposure. Digital cameras use auto-exposure to take care of exposing the picture for you. But there are a few things about aperture and exposure that you should be aware of. A digital camera will gather the same amount of light with a large aperture and a short exposure, or with a small aperture and a long exposure, but the image won't look the same. A wider aperture will reduce the depth of field, so that only objects at the focal point are in sharp focus. This is great for isolating a person from a busy background, but not so great for landscape photos, which require that everything be in focus. Cheap cameras have a fixed aperture, so only exposure is affected by light. More expensive cameras offer programmed exposure modes such as landscape, narrower aperture, greater depth of field, longer exposure, portrait, wider aperture, reduced depth of field, shorter exposure, and sport, shortest exposure to freeze motion, while high-end cameras also offer full manual controls. Even with a fully automatic camera, you can modify the exposure. Point the camera at the object you want correctly exposed and half-press the shutter button. Move the camera to compose your shot and then squeeze the button fully to take the picture. Many landscape photos turn out too dark because the exposure is overly influenced by a bright sky. The trick is to lower the camera so that the light meter exposes more for the foreground area and then press the shutter button partway in order to lock in the exposure. Then recompose the shot as before and press the shutter completely. Photography depends on light. Therefore, an understanding of light, what it is, how it behaves, and how you can learn to use it is essential to creating superlative photos. Because the character and quality of a photograph can be altered by the character and quality of light, even the most seasoned photographers puzzle over how a scene should be lit, what lighting angles to use for good results, and what exposure settings to bring out the best detail and tonal shading. When you are armed with the basic facts about light, you will find that such elementary questions become more easily answered. If you're taking an outside daytime picture, keep the sun at your back. Avoid shooting into the sun. If you do, it will cause a lens flare and you'll have a light streak going across your picture or other unwanted effects. The good news is that most digital cameras have fast lens apertures, which help them take good pictures in relatively low light. But no camera likes to take pictures in really low light without a flash. More good news. Most digicams have a built-in flash, and some allow you to use an external flash, which is many times more effective than a camera's built-in flash and helps preserve the camera's battery. Taking a picture at night can be a daunting proposition. Nighttime photography can produce some of the most dramatic images that you can create, and it can also be one of the more difficult types of photography to learn and master. Don't get too caught up in it, though. Play around with your camera's settings and know how you'll be able to achieve the best pictures at night. If your camera has automatic settings only, you may face some real challenges in your attempts at photography in the dark. Whether photography is a hobby or just a casual interest, you'll be well served if you invest in a quality camera that allows for adjusting the basic settings. Don't use the flash. Most on-camera flashes aren't effective past 5 or 6 feet in front of the camera. So at night, it may overexpose anything that happens to be in the foreground while underexposing the primary subject of the picture. If you're in doubt, set the shutter speed higher and then take care of brightening the exposure later during the editing process. While you might not have a lot of time to think about your lighting when taking candid photos, sometimes just using the flash or not using the flash can help tremendously. Speaking of that, flash photography. There's probably no type of photography that is more disappointing to the beginner than flash photography. Unlike natural light photography, where what you see can often be what you get, it is difficult to visualize what the effects of using flash will be. Flash is shut off until the moment of exposure, and then its illumination is too brief to visually evaluate what it does to your picture. The real learning process occurs over time, with trial and error. You should not expect to become an instant expert at flash photography, but persistence and observation, constantly comparing your pictures with earlier ones, and identifying not only the problems to overcome, but the successes you have achieved, will give you the experience you need to control flash and produce consistently good flash pictures. Generally, poor lighting conditions results in poor pictures. Usually, you don't need flash for normal daytime outdoor shots unless it's very gloomy. Keep in mind that flash has a very limited range, so it should only be used when the subject is fairly close. Use fill flash to help lighten up a subject which is in deep shadow. It's best to avoid using flash indoors unless absolutely necessary. It tends to burn out subjects and can create harsh shadows. A better choice is to bounce the flash off the ceiling if your camera and flash support this option. Another option is to let as much daylight in as possible and turn on all the lights. You have the option of using fill flash when there's enough light in the scene, but your subject isn't well lit. Under certain circumstances, you might want to turn the flash off and let the camera deal with the low light condition by increasing exposure. This won't work in very dim conditions, but can give better results than flash. Be sure to guard against camera shake. Digital cameras are less sensitive to light than traditional film cameras. If you're shooting indoors or in a low light situation, even with the flash, you should move close enough to the subject for the flash to be effective, no more than 10 feet away. If this is a concern, some digital cameras allow you to use accessory flashes or studio-type lighting. If you set your digital camera on auto, the camera will attempt to determine the need for flash based on the lighting conditions. But you still should use the manual setting when appropriate, such as using the flash in bright sunlight to reduce intense shadows. In typical indoor situations, there will probably not be enough light to take a normal handheld, well-exposed photo. There are many indoor flash photo opportunities you may be faced with. You may want to cast light on a group of people for a portrait photo. You may want to throw light into a room for an architectural photo. Or you may just want to cast light on certain objects in a lighted room that appears too dark for an exposure. If your camera's auto-exposure settings say that the photo would require a shutter speed slower than 1/60th of a second, then you probably shouldn't handhold the camera, or the photo would come out blurry. The reason it would come out blurry is because the shutter would be open long enough for any minor handshake to distort the composition. The use of a tripod or faster film will probably be needed, but many of us do not regularly carry a tripod. Most photographers simply use their flash bulb when they're inside. In order to take effective indoor flash photos, there are some techniques you should keep in mind. When using the flash, do not point it directly at a mirror or glass that will create a lens flare or just ruin the photo. Stand close enough to your subjects so the flash is actually effective, 4 to 10 feet. Try to make sure your main subjects are about the same distance away from the flash as each other, or some that are closer to the flash will appear brighter than ones that are farther away. Fill flash fills in the areas of a photo that would normally appear too dark. Fill flash can be used for sunny day portraits, for shadows on a subject's face, or to fill any shaded area that is out of the sunlight. Fill flash can also be used to cast light into a room where there are no shadows. Fill-in flash is ideal for backlit and sidelit situations. In a backlit situation, there will be a lot of light in the background, but none or little light cast on the front of the subject. This would normally create somewhat of a silhouette effect, but with a fill flash, it would balance the photo nicely. But in order for this technique to work, you must be careful to stay in flash range, which is usually around 4 to 10 feet. With common cameras, in order to add fill flash to a photo, just toggle the flash to go off when it normally would not be needed. Many photographers also choose to bounce the flash off a wall or ceiling to get a softer, diffused kind of light, commonly sought after for portraits. This kind of flash technique requires a flash that can be aimed in a direction that the camera is not pointed. It takes practice to refine this technique, and only a small percentage of photographers actually use it. Practice using flash in your photos, even when it is not necessarily needed, and pay attention to your results. The best way to become better at flash photography is to analyze your photos and try to figure out what you could have done differently in order to create a better flash-filled exposure. While flash photography is difficult sometimes, more often pictures are ruined by shaking. Avoiding the shimmy shake. Very few people have a completely steady hand when they hold their camera. Movement is natural, and shaking while taking a picture can be awful for the outcome and what you are left with. Camera movement is the most common cause of blurry pictures. How can you stop the shaking? If you're like me, I bought a digital camera with image stabilization. It has been a godsend for me since I have a constant problem with shaky hands. But there are ways to minimize shakiness when taking pictures. When a point-and-shoot picture is taken, the shutter stays open just long enough to make a good exposure. If there is not enough light, the shutter stays open so long that the image is blurred by the movement of the camera. Camera shake is caused during slow shutter speeds. If there is any movement while the shutter is open, it will show up as motion lines and ghost images. This often happens in low light with longer shutter speeds needed to expose the images. Many people think that ruined photos are blamed on focus when the real culprit is usually camera shake. How can you tell the difference? If you see ghost doubles in the image, the problem is camera shake. Actually, it's quite easy to tell. If your picture is blurry and jaggy, the camera was shaking. In fact, zooming makes camera shake worse. The more you zoom in, the more the camera shakes. Getting a sharp picture requires a much higher shutter speed than if you're using a wide-angle lens. So, when you're shooting while holding the camera, you need to have a faster shutter speed. Consult your camera's manual to learn how to do this. There are also things you can do yourself to help minimize camera shake. Start by planting your feet firmly on the ground. Steady your upper body by tucking your elbows in close to your sides. And hold your camera firmly against your face. Now you're ready for the big moment. Take a deep breath and gently squeeze down the shutter release in one motion. Gently now, if you press down too hard on the button, you could jerk the camera downward. Even breathing too hard can cause the camera to move. Try stabilizing yourself by leaning against a wall or a tree also. Of course, if you get a tripod, you can completely eliminate camera shake. But when taking candid photos, that's not a viable solution. However, using a tripod can be the shaky camera person's answer. So can a camera that offers image stabilization. The best advice we can offer is to hold still. Some cameras have only an LCD monitor for viewing, which means you have to hold the camera away from your face to see what you're shooting. It's hard to keep still in this position, but you have no choice unless your camera has a conventional optical viewfinder. Hold the camera in both hands and place your elbows in against your chest to steady it. Or lean against a wall, pole, tree, etc. In general, though, there are some great tips that you can employ for some great pictures. Photo basics. Here are some simple tips and rules that can help you to create better pictures. Use them as a guide to lead you in creating that extraordinary picture. But remember, there are exceptions to every rule. So if you think something will look good, don't be afraid to try it. Enjoy! This seems like a little thing, but oftentimes just taking a pause before pressing the button and really looking through the viewfinder can go a long way to improving your shots. Check that everything is in the viewfinder that you want, or that there isn't too much there. Check that the camera is straight and level. If you're shooting a person, try and watch that objects behind the subject do not appear cluttered around the subject's head. An example might be a lamp directly behind someone's head will tend to detract from the picture. Try shooting your subject from different angles, not just straight on. Oftentimes, a unique point of view can really add dimension to a picture. Don't be afraid to climb up that hill, stand on a chair, or even lie on your back. Great artists will go to great lengths to get that perfect shot. Try turning the camera 90 degrees and taking a vertical shot instead of a horizontal shot. This particular technique works great when shooting a picture of one or two persons. You will undoubtedly notice a time lag between pressing the shutter release and the exposure. This delay is necessary because your camera needs a little time for pre-shot calibration and to balance the colors. just hold the camera steady for a little longer than usual until you get used to the time delay. There's also a delay between shots as the camera processes the previous images. Some new cameras have buffers that let you continue shooting during the processing time, which is great for fast action photography. If your camera doesn't have a buffer, you'll have to wait between shots, so look for a camera with fast shot-to-shot time. If your camera lets you override the autofocus, you'll want to use this feature if you take a lot of action shots, or if you're shooting through glass. Even if your camera has a buffer, the autofocus may not react fast enough to give you sharp pictures if you shoot too quickly or the light is too low. Have you ever noticed that your shots sometimes have a cool, clammy feel to them? If so, you're not alone. The default white balance setting for digital cameras is auto, which is fine for most snapshots, but tends to be a bit on the cool side. When shooting outdoor portraits and sunny landscapes, try changing your white balance setting from auto to cloudy. That's right, cloudy. Why? This adjustment is like putting a mild warming filter on your camera. It increases the reds and yellows, resulting in richer, warmer pictures. Why do so many people own cameras? To capture special events and preserve them in time, of course. Many people take pictures of sporting events, their travels, and portraits. Are there tips for taking those pictures? You bet! Travel, sports, and portraits. If you're a parent, taking pictures of your child while he or she is participating in a sporting event is very important. When you get the chance to travel to a new and exotic location, pictures can be just as important to the overall enjoyment of the trip. Taking great travel pictures. First, you need to research where you're going. Use whatever resources you have to find out what the best spots are and where you will probably want to snap some pictures. There's nothing worse than going on vacation and finding out later that you missed out on a picture of a famous landmark or scene. If your travel adventures provide you with opportunities to take photos from a moving vehicle, be it a car, boat, plane, helicopter, or horse and buggy, remember that any sudden movement can turn a great picture into a useless blur. Before going on such an excursion, study your digital camera manual and learn how to increase your shutter speed so that your camera can take photos as quickly as possible. You may also want to adjust your ISO sensitivity higher to support faster shutter speeds. Note that both techniques may decrease lightness or introduce grain, noise, in your photograph, so you should always experiment to find a good balance. If you're taking a landscape photo, instead of taking a direct shot at the landscape, consider pointing your digital camera lens upward to grab more of the sky. It helps if you have a viewfinder that can swivel upward. This type of photograph can signify openness, freedom, and wide expanses, and may result in a pleasing picture. When doing this, you may want to first consider getting a spot reading on the landscape. Otherwise, pointing your lens towards the sky may result in the camera auto-exposing on its brightness, causing your landscape image to be washed out. If you don't know how to do this, you can instead try focus locking on your landscape. This will also lock your camera's exposure on the landscape's colors. Then rotate your lens upward and snap a photograph. Experiment to get the colors you desire. Being prepared is the best thing you can do for yourself when taking pictures while traveling. What will you need? Here's a checklist of items you may want to look through before going on a trip. Of course, your particular travel and photo needs may warrant extra preparation steps and the need to bring more equipment, so add to this list as needed. Clear and reformat your digital camera media, assuming you have backed up all photos currently on the cards. Charge all batteries. Make sure the digital camera and camera bag straps are secure. Turn on the camera, take a couple of test photos, and ensure everything is working correctly. Clean your digital camera using a cleaning kit, being careful not to scratch or damage the lens. Ensure you bring along the following: secured inside a digital camera bag, digital camera, extra filters such as a UV filter, extra batteries, media, cleaning kit. If you have access to a laptop, you might want to also bring that along in your travels. Even if you do have a mighty storage card, you might find yourself with 2 days to go on vacation and all memory cards filled up. If you have your laptop with you, you can simply download your photos every day and start fresh the next. Don't bring the farm when it comes to your digital camera equipment, especially if you have to walk a lot to cover a cityscape, village, countryside, etc. Limit what you carry. You may not need to bring all of your extra batteries, but just enough to cover a particular shoot. Leave the rest at home or in your hotel room, possibly in a hotel safe. If you are really into photography and have multiple cameras, you don't need to take all of them with you. A regular-sized and compact camera for taking quick shots should handle most, if not all, photo-taking opportunities. Only bring a tripod with you if it is absolutely necessary, as these add a lot of bulk. Be prepared, but not over-prepared, in that you wear yourself out lugging around extra unneeded equipment. Sports photography. I think probably the biggest tip I can offer you when it comes to sports photography is to take lots and lots of pictures. You're using a digital camera, right? Use the digital technology to your advantage. You're not shooting through rolls of film, so go ahead and take extra digital photos at a sporting event. First off, it helps in that the more practice you have, theoretically, the better you'll get at taking future photos. Second, with the split-second nature of a sporting event, it is hard, if not impossible, to record every single moment perfectly. Taking more photos increases the chance of getting that one great photo you will want to show. Get plenty of sleep the day before the event so you bring your A game to the venue. You don't want to be dozing off when your kid hits a home run. Also, get to know the layout of where you will be. You can pick out the best area to get the best pictures before you show up and save some valuable time. Everyone wants to record the occurrence of a great play. The contact between bat and ball as it is hurled towards the outfield. The fine release of a basketball as it gracefully begins its arc towards the basket. Or the forward motion of a quarterback tossing a football towards a wide receiver just as he is about to get blindsided by a defensive lineman. While these photos are great, you should also look at capturing the emotion after a great play has occurred. Take snapshots of the jubilation, smiles, and high fives, and don't forget the look of bewilderment on the other team's face after something special has occurred. Photos are supposed to tell a story, and capturing human reaction to an event may be more telling than capturing the event itself. Zoom is absolutely necessary. A long telephoto zoom is practically essential at sporting events. Unless you are a professional and commissioned to take photos at an event, allowing you sideline or bleacher access, you probably will not be seated as close to the action as you'd like. A long 7+ or higher zoom can make the difference between a photograph looking like a bunch of dots moving around versus one telling a story with detailed players' facial expressions. You will also need a fast shutter speed. Set your digital camera's shutter speed as fast as possible to handle photographs with the available light. This reduces the chance of camera shake if you are unable to use a tripod. Also, actions occur in the blink of an eye, and you don't want your photograph to be so blurry that you cannot recognize the players or movement. Granted, selective blurring can result in intriguing photos, but you also want the ability to take fast, crisp, clean shots. Study your digital camera manual for assistance in changing the shutter speed. Then, at the event, practice a few shots before the game starts to ensure you have enough lighting to support faster shutter speeds. You don't want your photographs looking all washed out. The more available light, the faster you should be able to shoot with your digital camera. And of course, correct use of flash can also allow you to use faster shutter speeds. Remember that there will still be shutter lag. When you press down on your digital camera's shutter, it will take a few milliseconds before it is pressed down firmly and a photo is recorded. You should practice taking photos with your digital camera before going to a sporting event to learn and be able to anticipate this shutter lag time. Note that lag time also increases during a camera's autofocus process. You can decrease this added lag time by setting your camera to manual focus mode or by keeping the shutter button halfway down, already autofocused on a particular area. If your digital camera has a burst or rapid shot mode, it may prove beneficial to your sports photography. During a fast-paced event, it is almost impossible to time every shot perfectly. Burst mode lets you set up your exposure, shutter speed, and other options as you anticipate a play, and, just as you expect a play is about to happen, such as a penalty kick, you can take several photographs in rapid succession. When purchasing a digital camera that you plan on using for sports photography, see if it has a burst mode. You should check to see how many photographs the camera can take in succession. How long will the burst mode work? Does it take 10 photos in 2 seconds, etc.? Also, find out what resolutions are supported by the burst mode. Some digital cameras may support 8 megapixels at RAW quality for normal photos, but only 5 megapixels at JPEG quality in burst mode, for example. Find out, too, if the camera requires high-speed memory to take burst mode shots. Portraits. When you're taking portraits, there are a lot of aspects to take into consideration. While you'll want to have some professionally taken portraits done throughout your lifetime, you can still take some great family pictures with your digital camera. Are you taking photographs of babies or other children? Take advantage of the most important feature of your digital camera, the ability to shoot lots of photos without wasting film. However, please limit kids' exposures to bright light if you insist on using flash. Kids, especially babies, are notorious for getting fidgety during a photo shoot. It may not be possible to set up a perfectly posed shoot with your subjects close to each other, all facing the camera, smiling bright with their eyes wide open. Children may look away from the camera, yawn, scratch their hair, etc. If it's impossible to get the perfect posed shot, consider taking extra action photos of them partaking in various activities. Keep your digital camera with you. Sometimes these activity shots or other unplanned shots are more memorable than studio portraits. Imagine which has more impact, a photograph of a posed child sitting on a chair, or one of them throwing their hands up while going down a slide, or right as they bite into a big, juicy watermelon. By taking plenty of photographs, you can help ensure that one of the pictures will turn out a winner. When taking photographs of babies or small kids, it is natural as an adult to point your digital camera's lens downward toward the child. However, this can often result in photos that look like the child is overwhelmed by the largeness of their surroundings. Consider kneeling or sitting when taking a photograph, shooting with your digital camera lens pointed directly at the child as to shoot from their eye level. This can better show how the world looks to them, possibly resulting in more pleasing photographs. When taking a photo of a group of people, don't be afraid to tell them to get in closer together. This is often necessary to ensure everyone's full face is in the LCD or viewfinder. You don't want to crop someone's ear, and you don't want to lose half of someone's face in the final photograph. Make sure everyone's face is well inside the frame, in case you have to rotate and crop the photo later to make it straight. If you've ever shot a photograph with more than just a couple of people, you're sure to know what the blinking syndrome is. Most everyone will be smiling, looking straight at the camera, but someone is going to blink. This may result in a less than pleasing photograph. Blinking is a natural reaction whenever people are exposed to bright light. And even if flash photography is not used, people are so used to it that they may tend to tense up in anticipation of the light, causing them to blink almost on reflex. So, how can one stop a group of people from blinking? If you have to use flash, make sure everyone is ready before you take the photo. Instead of taking just one photo, take 2 or 3 photos and plan on using the last one. After a couple of flashes, most people's eyes will get used to the light and they may not blink. However, don't overshoot with flash, as too much bright light may damage eyes. If at all possible, take your group photo in a well-lit area that doesn't require flash. Especially with today's modern digital cameras, you may be able to get away with changing some basic settings such as exposure time, if you can keep everyone still, to get a nice, bright picture. If you plan on doing this, make sure you tell everyone that flash will not be used so they don't tense up. When setting up a portrait shot, consider simplifying the background to avoid photo clutter. If you take a photo of someone in front of a busy background, when someone else looks at the picture, their eyes will wander all over the place. Your photos should focus the viewer on the person and only afterwards their surroundings. Instead of getting an entire mountain scene in the photo, just get enough so the viewer knows the person is in front of mountains. You cannot get entire skyscrapers in a photo and still record the details of a person's face, So unless you're just going for the effect of comparing the person's size with the largeness of their surroundings, focus on one background detail and let the person's image fill most of the viewfinder. When taking portraits, it's essential to make sure that your subjects are at ease and relaxed in order for you to get the perfect picture. Talk to them, smile, and be at ease yourself. When you mirror the behavior you want them to have, they're more likely to follow suit and the pictures will look incredible. Your pictures have been taken, and now it's time to download them to your computer. This too requires a little know-how in order to save them efficiently. Saving your pictures. So, you've taken some great shots. You know they look great because digital cameras let you see them right away. But now it's time to get your pictures out of the camera, and there are several ways to transfer files to your computer. The most common is via a cable that hooks into the serial port of your computer. Cameras come with software that lets a computer talk with the camera and retrieve pictures. A much faster way to transfer images into your computer is through a USB or FireWire port. These ports are similar to a serial port, but can send data at a much faster rate. Another way to get images into your computer is via a card reader. A card reader is a small external or internal device that accepts your memory card. Card readers can transfer photos at speeds up to 1 megabyte per second, many times faster than transferring from your camera. You can also use adapters, which let you insert memory cards into your computer's floppy drive. When you transfer images from your digital camera to your PC, take great care in that you do not overwrite images currently on your PC. In most instances where one transfers images from a camera to a PC, the same file names are used when you transfer different sets of files. Thus, you see that if you don't change the image file names on your computer, or if you don't make sure you transfer images to different PC directories, your photos on your PC can be overwritten by accident. Now that your photos are safely tucked away in your computer, what's the best way to file, manipulate, and sort them? If you take a lot of pictures, this can be a thorny problem because as far as eating up drive space is concerned, digital images are real hogs. Plus, you have to organize digital photos for the same reason you have to organize conventional photographic prints. If you don't, you can't find what you want without dumping a pile of pictures on a table and sifting through them. There are several formats you can save your pictures as. Part of the reason for having different file types is the need for compression. Image files can be quite large, and the larger file type means more disk usage and slower downloads. Compression is a term used to describe ways of cutting the size of the file. The terms lossy and lossless compression are often used in digital photography. A lossless compression looks for more efficient ways to represent an image, while making no compromises in accuracy. In contrast, lossy compressions will accept some compromises in the image in order to achieve smaller file size. A lossless algorithm might, for example, look for a recurring pattern in the file and replace each occurrence with a short abbreviation, thereby cutting the file size. In contrast, a lossy algorithm might store color information at a lower resolution than the image itself, since the eye is not so sensitive to changes in color of a small distance. It sounds complicated, but it doesn't have to be. Here are some of the most common file types and what they are good for. TIFF is, in principle, a very flexible format that can be lossless or lossy. The details of the image stored information are included as part of the file. In practice, TIFF is used almost exclusively as a lossless image storage format that uses no compression at all. Most graphics programs that use TIFF do not compress. Consequently, file sizes are quite big. The upside to using TIFF file as your storage medium is that you will have the best quality with little compromise. However, the file sizes are so large, you may experience some slowdown when editing and manipulating your photos. PNG is also a lossless storage format. However, in contrast with common TIFF usage, it looks for patterns in the image that it can use to compress file size. The compression is exactly reversible, so the image is recovered exactly. If you have an image with large areas of exactly uniform color, but contains more than 256 colors, PNG is your choice. Its strategy is similar to that of GIF, but it supports 16 million colors, not just 256. If you want to display a photograph exactly without loss on the web, PNG is your choice also. Later generation web browsers support